Thanks again for listening to the Indiana Bible College podcast. Want to make you aware of an important date coming up at IBC, and that's Indiana Bible College live recording. That happens February 2nd, 2018 at 7:30 in the evening. Tickets are on sale now. You can visit gotoibc.com/live. And thanks again for tuning in today. Welcome to 2018. Hard to believe we're saying that, but it's here. And also here is our message from our final chapel with Pastor Mooney, entitled, Where Will You Leave Your Glory?
Thank you. Clap your hands to the Lord. Clap your hands to the Lord. Jesus, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah. How many love the Lord with all your heart? How many know that the Lord has changed your life? So deep and powerful is this change in your life that you can't really measure it. You can't really weigh it. You can't even know how great God has been to you and to me. And the power of God, the influence of God upon our lives, and the power, the strength, all the things that come with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. What comes? Something comes from your commitment, your love for God, and your yes when God has called you or touched your life. How powerful is this, and how important is this? I think it is the most profound question that you could ask. Last night, I think the sophomore class was over to the house for a sophomore party, and I gave a little tour through my man's cave library back in the back of the house, and this is an old Bible that I've carried for a long time, and it has a lot of sermon notes in it and stuff. I haven't opened it in years. But last night after showing it to some of the students, I just kind of flipped it over, and I noted something that I had written and marked in the Bible. And it has to do with this great, profound question. It had been a long time since I had reviewed this question for myself. And it struck me hard last night and early this morning. So since your students and Bible students will go to Isaiah chapter 10, and we'll kind of leave out all the elements that are so important really to understanding this scripture, but we can read just a few verses and get the idea of what God was trying to awaken in the hearts and souls of the Old Testament church. And I think it's applicable to us today. Chapter 10, verse 1, woe to them that decree unrighteous decrees, and that write grievousness, which they have prescribed. In other words, the people that bring the things that are ugly and unrighteous and unwholesome, unclean, people that have, let's say, high intellect or great influence or power, political power, or just maybe the power of a human personality. And they use all of those things, gifts, if you please, special gifts, human gifts. Don't ever forget, there's a lot of human gifts. There's people today that are changing the world because of their ability to capture the power of the electronic age. And they realize that they have in their hands the opportunity to shape a new kind of world that's outside of anything men have ever imagined in the history of humanity itself. This is no small game you're going into. This is no little thing. This is not even a fad or a moment in time. It is a revolutionary button that has already been pushed. And quite frankly, you can't pull it back. the best and the brightest among the electronic geniuses of the world already realize that their power and their influence will revolutionize the world. However, they're not real comfortable with it. They not are really sure that they can depend upon humans themselves to do the right thing. So the question, the great question for your generation has to do with integrity and morals and the kinds of things that you do with your heart. Not just what you do physically, but what you do with your heart. Now let's see if we can, in that context, catch what the prophet Isaiah was being challenged by the Holy Spirit to say and to write to the ancient church. So you have these ones who prescribe certain things. They're not good things. And those elements of their wisdom and their agendas turn aside the needy from judgment. Everybody needs judgment, by the way. This is not corrupting people in the sense that you're not giving them the food that they need. But this is a power element, don't you think, brethren? Can you see it there? This is a powerful element that withholds what from people? Judgment. If you say to a generation that homosexuality is not a corrupting force within the context of the human nature and the human soul, I think you could call that corruption. And you could call that a lack of judgment. I wish I had someone with me now. And to take away the right from the poor of my people, to take away the right, judgment, right, from the poor of my people, that widows may be their prey, weak people, and that they may rob the fatherless. Wow. Not a very happy world here, is there? And what will you do in the days of visitation? And in the desolate, help me with that word.
Desolation.
That was funny for me. Which shall come far. It's called thinking and reading at the same time. Because I'm feeling a little something in this verse. Can I get a witness? Now the question, verse 3. What will you do in the day of your visitation? What are you going to do? Where will you flee? When the reality sets in, let's put it this way. I got a question for you, God says. And Isaiah, you go out and you ask the people. After they've given way, after they've made a way, after they've yielded, after they've synchronized themselves with all of these negative things, evil things, destructive things, after they have paralleled their own lives and thinking and spirituality. Here's the question. Look at it. What does it say? The next line, what is it? Where? What does it say? Where were you what? Oh, there it is. You may be seated. I remember when I first was dealing with this spiritually and personally many years ago, I was thinking about this question. I couldn't get it out of my mind for days. I brought it into the prayer, into my prayer time. I brought this question into my study time, and I brought it. It kept coming up again in my mind as I was going through the day. What a question. What are you going to do with this glory, this thing that God has given you? You can't just say, well, you can't ignore some things. Time, let's take for an example, time is time. You can fiddle around with your watch, and you can, you got a watch on? You could take a watch, and you got a nice big watch there, so you could push out this little thing and you could turn the little knob and you could set the watch back or you could set it forward. But your fiddling around with your little watch has nothing to do with the real time. So you could say, just to get a simple little illustration here, God is saying, now, you got all this stuff going on. You got all of these revolutions. You've got all of these people that are robbing and exploiting people, blocking justice, blocking the needs that even the widows and the poor, and just ignoring the consequences of the wrong spiritual path. Do you realize, of course you do, that believing the wrong thing has consequences. Walking away, let's say, from the Acts 2:38 message as we understand it, and as I believe we're challenged as God's people to preach it all over this world, just not dealing with that is a very, very powerful and an ugly mistake. And so God is saying, How far can you go with this? But yet, here comes the bigger question. If you've ever tasted, if you've ever touched, if you've ever known, if you've ever been in the relationship that is spiritual in nature, the spiritual relationship, that's what the baptism of the Holy Spirit is. Being born again of the Spirit. Being reshaped and remade. So if you've ever tasted it and you really know that it's real and it's really real, if you had to substitute that or you chose to substitute that for something else, God says, where would you leave your glory? The glory, what is glory? Well, you can get it all in context, so I won't spend too much time with that. What God had done for you, what God has given you, what God has brought to you through the prophets and the teachers, what you have found in prayer, what you've experienced in worship, that blessing that's come upon your life that's shaped you and given you a song in the darkest of your nights and given you hope for your future and given you a cause. We're not just going to church. God has placed a cause in us to go to church. He's not just blessed us in some materialistic way. He's also changed us inwardly, internally. It's called the heart, and that's where he's reshaped us. And once you've tasted, once you've seen it, once you've touched it, once you've felt it, there is a big question hanging over all of our heads. Where would you, if you had to lay it down, where would you lay it down? If you had to dispense with that glory, where would you put it? And could you ever really get away from it? Is it really possible for a born-again, apostolic, Pentecostal person to really ever get away from it? I'm going to tell you, my life experience is, you can disagree, but my life experience is I've never found anybody that's ever forgotten what God did for them. I know a lot of people that have backslidden and gone their own way, seeking after their own ambitious things, seeking after even lustful and hurtful things, or maybe it's money, or maybe it's fame or fortune, or whatever it is they pursue, but they never, if they walk away, they never quite walk away completely. The question holds, the question's profound, where will you leave your glory? Because see, being filled with the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not only just a once-in-a-lifetime experience, it's something that places within you a revolutionary concept about who you are and what you could be. You begin to get a feeling of what might happen in your life through the enableness of God, how God enables us, he helps us. That's what lives in us right now. Because all of us know our weaknesses, we know our faults, we know our setbacks, we know that we can do very little, but there's something that speaks to us. If you'll just follow me, if you'll just walk with me, if you'll just put your hand in my hand, if you will let me show you and teach you and work through you, all things are possible. And sometimes we look at this world and think, well, they've got it all together. But there's another little group of people that really have it all together, that have an answer, that have a hope, that have something that's working in their life that they could share, that they could preach to the world, give to the world. And that anointing and that power and that transformation and that infilling of the Holy Spirit will lift you to a high place, will take you to where God wants you to be, that will demonstrate to you a joy that is unspeakable, a joy that is full of glory, a peace that surpasseth understanding. You can't, the work of God, the power of God, the anointing of God in your life is not even, cannot even be compared. There's nothing in this world that is worthy to be compared with what God has given us through the Holy Ghost. Can I get a witness? So where will you leave your glory? Without me, they shall bow down under the prisoners, and they shall fall under the slain. For all this, his anger is not turned away, but his hand is stretched out still. I'm trying to get through to you, God says. Where will you put your glory? Where will you put your identity? What can you do with that history? Where are you going to put that? Those words from Abraham and Isaac and Jacob? There's a little, whatever criticism we might have of the Jewish religion, there's something very moving when you see those young boys around the Wailing Wall rocking back and forth, and an old bishop there watching them closely to make sure that they memorize their ascribed segment of the Bible. And they've got to deliver that text. They've got to know it. They've got to know it so well that they could quote it immediately. Our guide said to us one time when we were in Israel, said, you have to be so fearless that in case you needed to quote the scripture on your deathbed, you could get it right. Because even if you burned all the books, the reason these young people are trained in Israel to memorize certain segments of the Bible is so that it will never be lost. There's no place to put your glory. There's no place to put the revealed word of God. You can't just throw it away. You can't set it aside. So let us put it in the hearts. Let us get it in the hearts, they say. Let us put it in the mind. Let's make sure that all of our young men memorize the scripture. So your responsibility is to remember this chapter, and yours is to remember another chapter and another chapter. And if we all got together, we could put the Bible back together, even if somebody burned all the books in the world. You just can't get away from this word. It's forever settled. It's finished. I believe I could point out to you what Jesus said on the cross. It's finished. So suppose you backslide. Where are you going to go? Today, in the past few days, I've dealt with 2 13-year-old suicides. It's not easy, especially when parents are separated from God, have long not been in church. The guilt rushes in on them. You don't have to say anything. They know. Where would you put your glory? Where would you put your experience? How do you get rid of that touch? Just that one touch. It's like this is a bad illustration, but it's like having met somebody. I can remember getting in the line there with my schoolmates and shaking hands with Ronald Reagan. That was a pretty special day. It's like something in your life, and this is kind of a small thing, but, you know, you never forget that. You know, I could still just, you know, in a certain kind of emotional way, I can still kind of feel the way his hand was a little limp at first, and it's like he knew it. It's like he didn't really, he's some high school kids from Charlottesville, Indiana. Who wants to shake hands with these little kids? And all of a sudden, he just got a hold of a hand, and all of a sudden, he kind of leaned back in. I can never forget that. And he squeezed real hard. He didn't say anything. He wanted to get on the helicopter. It was out there. But you can't. Where do you put that? Where do you put an experience that's just kind of unique? And there you are, a senior in high school, and the man, you know, Ronald Reagan, was gripping our hands and wishing us well. He may have been completely in the, what would you call it, just political mode. He was just trying to get on his helicopter. And his staff had a group of kids lined up. But there's touches in life. There's things in life that you don't ever really get rid of. And I'm just talking about something that's carnal and relatively, and it's not all that important. But think about, I went to a meeting one night. Something touched me. Something got a hold of me. Something changed me. Mom had talked to me about it. My pastor had talked to me about it. My father had talked to me about it. But let me tell you, I didn't really understand it until he came into my life. Do you realize you're not just here at IBC? I know some of you may have come for this reason or that reason, but I have a feeling that most of you in this room have some kind of calling, some kind of dynamic, a spiritual dynamic that's working on you, and God saying to you in those times when you're kind of alone and you're trying to figure it all out, and maybe you're tired and you're wore out and you're thinking this is not going to work, and I'm not, you know, maybe I don't know if I'm doing the right thing or not. It's just, but something comes and says, wait a minute now, where are you going to put that calling? Where are you going to... You can't just put it on a shelf. You can't forget. I can't forget what he's done for me. When I wake up every morning, I realize that there is a God that's bigger than I am. And he walks with us and he talks with us. Somebody say hallelujah. Where can you leave this glory? What can you do with what God has done in your life? These are very, very important things. Our identity. The new name that he's given us, the new power that he's given us, the relationship that he has given us through the Spirit. Where are you going to store this? And suppose we just decide somehow, and I don't believe anybody in this room is on that path, at least I pray, God forbid, to throw away this apostolic message, this idea, that's a bad idea, because what God has revealed to us, what God has done for us, when we were baptized in his name and filled with the gift of the Holy Ghost, something got a hold of us. We're in a culture of unbelief. We're in a culture that has decided to throw away Christian principles and the ideas of the Bible. The whole structure of moral principles are being shaken right in front of our very eyes. We're seeing our children being exposed to graphic, horrible violence and horrible, graphic, perverted sexual activity, and little children are fearful to the point where suicide now is one of the most is the number one killer. I think it's still number one. The number one killer of children today is self-killing, suicide. Do you ever realize how hard that is to deal with? How do you work through that? What do you say to people? You owe it to yourself and you owe it to your generation. If God has filled you with the Holy Ghost, you get a grip on this message. And you don't allow the people, your own peers, who would try to break off from you and tear out of your heart, to rip out of your heart what God has given. Am I preaching all right today? Because there's always somebody out there that wants to drag you back to the ugly and the perverted, and to drag you back to the things that will cause loss in your life and failure in your life and disappointment in your life. But if you hold to that unchanging hand, if you wake up every morning and say, God, I don't really know. I don't really know where you're leading me. I don't really understand where my calling is going to end. But one thing I want you to know, where you lead me, I will follow. I'm going to stay in the game. I'm going to stay in church. I'm going to keep on praising you. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Can I get a witness? Do I have anybody that's determined? I'm going to make it. I'm going to overcome. I'm going to be a light in this dark world. I'm going to lift up the name that is above the name. I'm going to practice righteousness and holiness. And the last thing I'd want to do is to pull righteousness away from people who need to know what righteousness is. The worst thing you could do is to exploit your own generation in believing that the Holy Ghost is not necessary. Don't get in with the cool guys and the cool gals that think you don't really need to speak in tongues. You don't really need this Acts 2:38 thing. You are a liar. You do need that. You do need God's help. We all need God's help. We're nothing without him. Through him, all things are possible.
But you can't build a church by yourself. You can't do a revival by yourself. I wish I could get a little help in this place. You need something from on high that transforms you, that makes you, molds you, shapes you. And by the way, where would you leave your glory? And could you actually leave your glory? Or would it always be that haunting thing? I could tell you stories. I don't want to tell you stories. Just let me. I think you will be able to receive this as an honest expression. I can't tell you how many times people sometimes come by the house or call on the phone and say, I don't know, maybe I get at least two or three calls a month. People saying, I don't know, Brother Mooney, I made a mistake. My church, I got people in church, but they don't even know they're in church now. It's not like it used to be. Well, what happened? Somebody decided to just kind of put the glory on the shelf. Put the anointing. We don't need that. Maybe we can do this with our talent. I'm looking at talented young people, maybe some of the most talented young people in the United Pentecostal Church, but your talent will take you a very short way, and that's about it. But oh, his glory, his anointing, his will, his purpose, the light that he gives you, a light of understanding, a light that turns on and becomes clear, a kind of right that becomes a righteousness, a definable truth that you function in. And you can say to the weak and to the poor and to the sinners and to the undone, I know a name, I know a place, I have an answer. What he's done for me, he'll do for you. I know where you can go and find joy that's unspeakable. Come on, let me take you to my Father's house. The songwriter said, come and go with me to my Father's house, to my Father's house. That's where the glory is. And once you've tasted it, once you have felt it, the question is there, where would you put it? What would you do with it? I don't know all the things that we're facing, but I do believe that we're at a crossroads. You hear me say it all the time because I really want to awaken you as much as I can. Are we going to get so cool that we won't acknowledge the fact that we have glory working in us? We want people to focus on our personality and not our anointing. You know, it's so easy just to feel like you're so cute and so fancy and so talented that the whole world will want your autograph and want to listen to you because you're so talented. But over time, everybody's era and everybody's moment passes, changes. It all becomes something else but his glory. It doesn't matter who you are. It doesn't matter what you go through. John said, we have handled him. Imagine if you were in the apostolic age, and imagine that the revelation of the mighty God in Christ became clear to you, that this is not just a man, but he's the Lord God of the universe, and he has robed himself in flesh. I'm just a rhetorical question. Do you believe that they finally understood that he was more than just a man? They understood it. They got it. It was tough because who had ever seen a true God-man, if you want to say it that way? It's probably not a very good way to say it, but wow. And you realized that day that you were out there and he was breaking the bread and you reached out and you took the broken pieces of bread and realized that God himself manifest in the flesh. Where do you put that knowledge? You say, well, we were not there. Wait. That anointing that fell upon your life, that calling that works in you right now, that call into the ministry, that call into missions, that call into developing your life, and that call that you have on your talents, your music, your keyboard playing, and all of that. And I do pray, you know, just as a person, can I throw this in? I hope we don't end up with a church that has nothing but a keyboard and drums and a bass guitar. I hope that this is going over like a lead balloon, but I'm going to say it. I hope somebody learns to play the trumpet and just blow the socks off the bass player. Bum, 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 bum. All right, get that trumpet out. Blow that trumpet. You understand what I'm saying? You got a sense of humor? Whatever your talent is, don't let anybody push you around. If God anoints you to get the violin, play the violin. Who's our man up there in Montreal plays the violin? Taquan, yeah. I don't want Taquan on the drum. I want him with that delicate, masterful violin. And thank you. Because you see, whatever your calling is, don't let anybody push you around. And in that same sense, what God has given for the church to do in this world is bigger and more powerful than what men have in their hands. We know now that men, this is not something I'm just saying because it maybe is something to say. This is something you need to measure and think about and deal with. Because it's about your children, it's about your future. You now have men that know that the tools that they have control of and that they own, and I'm speaking of electronic tools. Let's just take artificial intelligence for an example. This past week we learned that this is kind of a prototype at this point, but at an airport you can walk up to one of these machines. Whether it could be a machine standing on two legs as if it were a man, but you don't need to build one of these artificial intelligent robots to look like a man. It can be a little box, for an example, or it can be something like this. And inside that, as you walk past it, they now can push a button and they can scope your life and your identity, and these machines now can deal with full personal profiles of human beings. They can do 1 billion in a few seconds. That means they could profile one robot, one tool of artificial intelligence. This is how powerful it is. They can fully profile 1 billion people in a nanosecond. So they say. Wow. Now, what we're putting in the hands of men is so powerful that even the men who now control some of these systems or who are developing these systems, big, large corporations, the massive, if you want to see this for yourself, anybody here from California, you can go into the valley. You can see, what do you see? What's a little town south of Sacramento? Not a little town, but help me. No, Stockton. No, the suburbs of San Francisco. What's where all the computer guys are at? What is that? What? Silicon Valley. But what's the name of the city? San Jose. So you go down to San Jose, right? And in San Jose, what you would see if you drove around, which I did just a few months ago, and what do you see? You see these massive, 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 massive installations of all kinds. And they're mostly, they're computers, and they're walled in, and they are massive artificial intelligent components that are going to be able to monitor every living person. I have a nephew, a great nephew. He's my nephew's son who works in the valley. He's a PhD. He works there every day. And I said to him not too long ago, a year ago now, we had this conversation. He said, Uncle Paul, I don't even want to tell you how wicked some of those people are. How bad they are. Do you realize that there's never been a power grab in the world that hasn't been used against people? Hitler grabbed the power and he used it for his own well-being. Notice, woe unto them that decree unrighteous decrees and that write grievousness which they have prescribed, and they turn aside the needy from judgment and take away the right from the poor of my people, that widows may be their what? Widows. We could pray on you. You're like a tool. You're a toy. You're like a toy. And people that are in this, am I a little too low here? See, I don't have solutions. You don't have solutions, I don't think either, to all these problems that you're going into. And you can't try to go back to the past. That's not even what I'm suggesting. I'm suggesting that you come forward with an understanding that there is a God that has given you something that is, in a sense, of equal power, something that's called his glory. And that glory means that God is going to reveal himself through the church, through the people that hold this knowledge and hold this understanding. You can't stop this. In the last days, God's going to still be working. He's not going to say, oh, we've got these artificial intelligent things now, and men can capture the whole world in a sense. And this is very frightening. I know. I don't want to sound like I'm trying to scare you in some way, but it should be of a concern to us. But let us not forget, if we hold to God's unchanging hand, you are the only one that can put aside your glory. You are the only one that can say, I don't want this anymore. But if you love God and you want God's blessing, let me tell you, God will be there for you. He'll be there every day. He'll be there to anoint you and bless you, and he'll find a solution for you. You don't have to do this by yourself. Greater is he that is in you. Somebody help me now. Greater is he that is in you than he. His glory supersedes the power of men. I know they have an agenda, but God has an agenda as well. It's expedient that I go away, that I might send the Comforter. That was one of God's agendas. He said, I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit. And that power is going to be so powerful that through that anointing and that power of the Holy Spirit, I'm going to keep you and take you through every trial. You're not going to just have to learn to preach. Open up your mouth and God will fill it. It's not a technique. It's not about academics altogether. Although you shouldn't be foolish. You shouldn't try. You shouldn't be fearful of education or preparing yourself, but at the end of the day, you want to walk to every pulpit you are invited to walk up to and speak the truth and let the glory of God touch you and the anointing of God touch you, and don't worry about what other people think about it. Just lift up that name. Let God touch you. Let him get into your life. Let him get into your marriage. Let him get into your brain. Let him get into your ambition. And all things are possible. Stand to your feet right now and just pray. Lift your hands and say, God, I want your glory to be on me. I want your glory to walk in my life. What can we do? In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. So where are you going to store the Holy Ghost? You can't lay it down. You can't store it someplace. And you can't ignore it. How many know it's real? It's real. I know it's real, the songwriter said. This Pentecostal blessing. I know it's real. It's real. You see, listen closely when you hear people from an earlier generation speak to you, and they're trying to say to you, be careful that you don't let your music get away from the story of the glory and the story of the anointing. Make sure that it's right and that you're lifting it up, because you're going to have to teach it to your children. You're going to have to bring it close to your heart. And a little lie is a bad thing. Something misrepresented is a bad thing. If you know what he's done for you, you got to tell the world. Your testimony matters. You got to lift it up, and he will bless the whole world. But somebody's got to say, I can't just lay this down. I can't walk away from this. Something happened to me. Something changed my life. Clap your hands one more time, IBC. John said, you may be seated. John said, I have handled him. I have touched him. Therefore, John knew he could not go back. Touched who? He touched God. Wow. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 4, he said, and by the way, my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom. That's not what I was trying to do. Don't try to be a pretty preacher. I heard somebody say one time that they, this is a true story. I'll leave the names out, obviously. You can quote it because they need to hear it, that it's rumbling around. That they were trying to get a preacher for a certain UPC meeting, and they didn't want to have so-and-so because he sweat. As poor idiots. You better hope you got a sweating preacher somewhere in your life. Somebody that will pour it out. Paul said, I didn't come to you with enticing words of men's wisdom. And he could have. There he was, post-Aristotle. There he was among the Greeks. There he was among the temples. There he was among the political power. One of the greatest political powers that ever existed, the Roman Empire. But he said, I didn't come to you with all that. I came to you in the demonstration, the power and the demonstration of the Holy Spirit. Isn't that what you want to happen? Because where are you going to lay that down? Where are you going to put it? Where will you leave your glory, your story, your song, your fire, your hope, your Holy Ghost? You can't just put that aside. You can't put it aside for the applause of men. You can't put it aside for fame or fortune. You can't put it aside for just for ego reasons because you want the approval of men. Something happened to me. Something got a hold of me. I can't ever turn around. The cornerstone of my life has already been set. And I'm going to walk. I'm going to build. It's not political power. Can I get a witness? It's not intellectual power. There's probably not a history book now that you couldn't pick up and read about Christianity and what were the elements of its failure, especially in Europe. And we know, of course, that was a very complex compacted functions of Christianity, the whole revolution and the protest against the Catholic Church, all that kind of stuff. But what really failed that potential revival was the intellectualization of Christianity. And once they got into that, there was some good that came out of it, no doubt, because God can always bring some good out of even the worst of things. But what he had given the church was on the day of Pentecost, go into all the world and preach the gospel and do it under the power and demonstration of the Holy Ghost. So my question as I close, where would you put your glory? If you had to do away, if somebody stepped into your life and suggested that, you know, you don't want to just be an old holy roller, you know, that's all passé and there's a new way of doing things. You better be careful before you deal with some of those ideas and ask yourself this question. I know that I know. I know that something touched me. So where would I place my glory? Where would I put it? Could I just make it go away? Could I forget about it? Could I just say it never happened? I don't think I could do that. Could you? And if it was good for you, it would be good for your friends and your generation. Because I believe the only way that you're going to hold this generation, get a hold of this generation, or get this generation focused, is through the anointing and power of the Holy Ghost. And if you will speak, if you will follow your calling, and if you will speak the word of God without fear and without favor, God will anoint it. He will draw others to you. And when you look back on your life, you can say, I fought a good fight, and I kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me what? A crown of what? Righteousness. And you can't be in the righteousness business and be extorting people or exploiting people and keeping people away, because we didn't have time to talk about this, but we should talk about the fact that the anointing and Holy Spirit that comes into a person's life does work within that person's life, justice and fairness, and it works to bring people into the light and into the understanding. That's what you're giving to people. You're giving people hope. You're not just giving them a church membership. You're giving them a connection with the Word of God, which brings the balance into their life. What are we going to do? This final point now. This is the question. What are we going to do? with the artificial intelligence that we already see it in it. This is just in its beginning stage, where one of these little boxes or one of these little people-looking types of computers that stand in front of you and say, yes, you're okay to go into the restaurante because you have passed the description. One of these artificial guys, artificial intelligence guys, says, we're close to being able to control everything in the world. Money. We can turn off your entertainment. We control your entertainment. We'll be able to control every aspect of your travel. We will know where you're at 24 hours a day. You will never have to look for a criminal anywhere. You'll know where he's at. And you'll also know where the churches are gathering. The Bible says that something's going to happen the last day, Brother Rodenbusch, that will be so horrible that men will run for the rocks and the mountains for fear. Just fear. So you say, Brother Mooney, I hate it when you come into the chapel and make us feel so bad. Well, I'm sorry, I didn't invent your world. But you better figure out how to live in it. And how do you live in? Just take that little thing called glory. I know what he's done for me. And hold it and cherish it. The calling that you have. It wasn't your grandma. It wasn't your daddy. It wasn't your mama. It was God that called you to this higher thing. And I don't believe it's an accident. I thank you for being at IBC. And I thank you for being faithful to your church and to your pastor. And I thank you for yielding to the anointing. And you say, well, I'm not very talented. Get that out of your mind. Don't worry about it. God's going to help you. You do not have to be an intellect. There's always people going to be smarter than you. I avoid really smart people because it's embarrassing to be around them for me. But God still just blesses, you know. You do what you can do, and you'll be surprised how God will anoint you. And he's not even looking for somebody that's smart, because there's nobody that's smart enough to do what God needs to have done in this world. So how did God do it when he was calling disciples? He said, Peter, what are you, a fisherman? Yeah, a fisherman. Come on, Peter, throw those nets away and follow me. Stand with me, if you would. No place to go. No place to go. How many want his presence on your life? Have I made any sense today? Would you lay your hand on your friend's shoulder? Listen to me, IBC. This is not a clubby thing. I'm not saying this in a clubby way, because we're not a club. And I want you to get deeply acquainted with the people you're going to school with right now. Love one another. Help one another. You don't all have the same talents. You don't all have the same, destinies. Some of you will be missionaries, pastors. Some of you will maybe never really receive a call to preaching ministries, but you'll be on the team. We're getting ready. We've been in some multi-million dollar operations at Calvary. We're getting ready to launch another big. I want to tell you, I don't even worry so much about all the details of what it's time, effort, and energy that we have to expend in the next couple years to really get our project finished. But you know what? The Lord has given to Calvary Tabernacle so many fabulous laymen, people that are business people, people that have, God has put them in touch with politicians and they know our city. Just to be able to walk into a boardroom where people are educated in their particular specific professions. They have contacts throughout the community. That's what God does. He's always way ahead of you. So you say, well, I can't do all these things. I say, just put it all in the hands of God and wait for God. They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. So the anointing's there. The answer to the question, there is no place for you to hang up your glory, because it is what you are once you've tasted the heavenly gift. And if you pastor for a while, the phone will ring and you haven't seen Brother so-and-so in 20 or 25 years, is this not true? And they will call and say, Pastor, I never have forgotten those days. I never have forgotten when I was in church. Every Sunday I think about it, I need to be in church. The world has just messed me up. You know what that is all about? There's no place to put your glory. You can't get away from it.
Want to make you aware of an important date coming up at IBC, and that's Indiana Bible College live recording. That happens February 2nd, 2018 at 7:30 in the evening. Tickets are on sale now. You can visit go to ibc.com/live.